As I'm filming this right now, the total solar eclipse is only 4 days in the future. And I'm thinking of putting something together to make a camera track the sun so I can film it.
And I already have this rotating platform that I built years ago, so I was thinking I just need something to elevate the camera and that can optically track the sun.
But how do I make sure my algorithm can actually track through the period of totality? I have no way of testing that ahead of time.
So much simpler is going to be to just tilt this platform so it lines up with the Earth's axis and make it turn once every 24 hours, and I don't need to track the sun. So I got about a 15-to-1 reduction on here, and I need to do one step of the motor every 28 seconds to make a once every 24 hour turn. And this is doing one step every second, and you can really see that move when it steps, so that could be a little jerky. Especially if I put a long arm on there to see what it looks like at a distance. You can see that's really jumping around a lot. But my stepper driver supports micro-stepping, so I can divide physical steps of the motor into up to 32 smaller steps. So I'm just going to reconfigure that via dip switches. First three off. And now the steps are too small for me to see here. And if we look at the end of the stick here, that still shakes quite a bit from the stepping. But of course, that has some resonance to it. But if I just attach a stick straight to the motor pulley and look at it here, you can see that motion is still quite jerky.
So it would be better to have more reduction, but even better would be just some kind of a DC motor running slowly, maybe with a belt drive. But there's not much time left.
But then I realized I was actually planning on taking a time lapse with one picture every 5 seconds or so. And at that point, I can just make the adjustment, let it settle, and then take a picture, and the jerkiness won't matter. So I wrote a little bit of code, and right now with the time interval set to 3 seconds, it actually moves really nicely. Not too much bouncing around, but that's because I set the step rate to not mess with the harmonics of this chopstick here. Of course, the camera will be different. I've been trying to check the consistency of my intervals if I go for 5 seconds, and I've marked where the end of this pointer goes, and the interval is not exactly consistent. It doesn't help that sometimes I'm doing 5 steps and sometimes 6, but the bigger inaccuracy is that microstepping just isn't that accurate. So now with a camera on here that's fairly telephoto hooked up to the Raspberry Pi and stepping and taking photos, I should ideally get a smooth panning motion as it pans across the view here. But looking at the video, it's a little bit jerky in its motion, and the sun is only going to be about this big with that level of zoom. So I did it again, consistently stepping 3 microsteps, and I still get that jerkiness. So basically, the microstepping just isn't consistent enough. But in my various collections, I found these 2 pulleys and an extra belt, so I could try reducing that a little bit. I just finished cobbling together my reduction here, and it looks quite nice, but then I turn this, and notice how this keeps jumping, and that's because this timing belt is not quite the same pitch as the wheel on here. Oops. So now I just flip that belt teeth facing outwards, and now it runs perfectly smooth. And I think that'll be fine because I don't really need absolute precision. With that extra reduction, I get over 250,000 microsteps per revolution, and running that at 15 times actual speed, the end of that stick actually moves pretty smoothly now.
And for 5 second intervals with a sun, I need to do about 13 or 14 steps between pictures. And just doing a panning experiment, that seems to pan fairly smooth now.
And that's taken with a Raspberry Pi HQ camera module attached to a 50mm lens, which is pretty long for such a small sensor. But this camera lens is 135mm focal length. I just need a way of mounting that to my camera module. I can just barely screw in a screw mount extension tube straight into the wood now. And on this side, the knurled part of the S-mount fits nicely in there as a friction fit. So with the extension tube in here and the S-mount in here, I think I have my lens adapter thingy. Well, I made this thing to go with a 20mm extension tube, but that turns out to be too long. A 10mm one will be too short, but I have lots of focus adjustment here to make up for it. But as it is right now, I can't focus to infinity, which is no good.
I've been photographing this camera battery, and the text spacing on here is 1.5 millimeters per line. And photographing that at 3 meters away with a 135 millimeter lens, I get this sharp, and the sun would be roughly about this big on here, so a reasonable amount of detail. I also photographed it with that 50 millimeter lens, and the image is much sharper, but of course it's a fair bit smaller. And if I zoom in on that to be the same size, we just don't have enough pixel density in the sensor to get that writing, whereas on here we can get it. Although I can tell here just from how this image looks that we're very much limited by the lens. And that's using this lens at f8, which is probably about as sharp as it'll get. Whereas this one, I was using at f4, which just tells me this is an incredible lens that's made for these digital sensors to have a much higher spatial resolution than the film ever had. These 35mm lenses with a teeny little sensor on the end, they're just not that sharp. Oh, and on top of that, this is actually a zoom lens, whereas this is a fixed primary. But then I realized I also have a 180mm screw mount lens, so I put that on there, photographed that again, and now looking at that, this is with a 180mm lens, very legible, whereas with a 135mm, not so satisfactory, and 50mm, not legible at all. I've been experimenting with varying the aperture on the lens to see what gives me the sharpest image. The aperture is usually focal length over whatever, so f22 is focal length over 22, and 4 is focal length over 4, and the smaller I make the aperture, say f22, I get way more depth of field, which means it's much easier to get focus and lens aberrations are less of an issue, but I run into diffraction limits, whereas if I open up the lens further, I get more light, but now the lens limitations also become a factor, and depth of field, so if my focus is a little bit off, that's bad. So here's some test images. At f4, it's legible, but not great. Then if I switch to f5.6, it's becoming much more clear. At f8, slight improvement. f11, also quite good. But then once we get to f16, it's starting to get blurry again. And f22, it's really quite blurry. And that's diffraction limits at the small apertures and lens aberrations at the larger apertures. So ideally, I'll use an aperture in the range of f11 to f5.6. Of course, I have to make that work with the exposure of the sun, so depending on what filter works best, I may have to pick possibly outside that range. But I'm starting to question whether I'll have this thing ready by the time of the eclipse, especially with the first sunny day being the day of the eclipse. It's going to be cloudy up to that day. And a quick panning test with that 180mm lens, looking not too bad. This would be about 15 minutes of real time, so if I wasn't following the camera with my mechanism, I would lose it pretty quickly. I made a mount for this lens here, and I'm actually grabbing the lens by this front thing here, but I can still focus it, very important. And this is actually inclined by about 8 degrees because we are on the summer side of the equinox, which is to say the sun, if we're at the North Pole, would always be about 8 degrees above the horizon, which means this needs to be inclined 8 degrees, and then this axis needs to be lined up with the Earth's axis, which is why I added this foot here, and that should put it at the right incline to correspond with where we are. Man, I just hope this thing is going to work the day of the eclipse. I'm testing this right now. This is looking at one of these bulbs 10 meters away, so it gives you an idea how much magnification I've got. And I've also added an aiming device because it's very difficult to even get the light in view. So as long as the sun shining through this hole here ends up going through this hole here, I know it'll be in frame. And I also made this bracket to hold my auto-darkening welding filter in front of the lens. It can be quite unclear in various positions. Although at one position it's not too bad, but not as clear as without. Now, if I could move that filter from front here to near the sensor, then its deflection wouldn't make the image so fuzzy, but then the light wouldn't hit the solar cell on here and it wouldn't darken anymore. So that's no good. And I've been playing around with other sort of darkening filters, like these sunglasses, and they make things really fuzzy. Optically not very good. Also these eclipse glasses, but they are so incredibly dark that I just don't have anything bright enough to even see through those things.
Looking at straight at the sun with them, you can barely see the sun. They're so dim. But I've also tried these little spy glasses that the kids have that have basically a mirror on the sides to see behind you. But that mirror is not fully opaque. I can see light through there. And that turns out to be optically not a bad light reducer. So if I take a lens out of one of those and somehow put it back here, that might work. Okay, that's tough stuff. I cut the slot wider than I needed because I wasn't sure if one lens would be enough. But sticking that half mirror in here and locking the rest of it with this piece of wood, I can now get my light 10 meters away this clear, which I'm pretty happy with. And I also made an aperture to go on the front of the lens instead of using the one back here. And that way most of the heat from the sun will not get inside the lens. And with the settings I'm using right now, I can still reduce my sensitivity by a factor of 100. And I figure the sun is probably about 100 times brighter than that LED light I've got up there. Of course, to get the best shot of the eclipse, the logical thing to do would be to spend a few $1,000s on gear, but my goal is to see, can I do it with the stuff I have? And so far, my total spend is $2 for these things here. Today's the day of the eclipse. It's also the first sunny day in a long time, so I can finally test how dark my filters are. And testing with one of those kids' spyglass mirror type filters, that was way too bright. So I used a filter for one of these eclipse glasses out front, and that worked awfully dim though. But to get better image quality, I thought I'd try to put it at the focal plane, and that worked for a little bit. Then suddenly my image got really, really bright because I was focusing the sun onto this thing here, and it burnt a hole through it. And afterwards, I could see a speck on my sensor, and I thought, oh no, I burnt a hole in the sensor, but it was just a speck of dust that I hadn't paid attention to before. But these things, aside from being awfully dim, they also make it rather orangey, so I went back to these kid spyglass filters, and then I put the other lens in the back, mirror facing forward, and between those two, I get a reasonable exposure. And looking at some of my time lapses with just a plain sun, it seems to be jumping around an awful lot, and I thought maybe there's something unsteady about my device, but no. So this is a live view, and that sun, it's just jumping around a little bit. As if I use my eclipse projector, so this is a mirror, here's a 1/8 diopter lens, and that projects onto the wall here, and if I look at that, this is actually the clearest image I can get of the sun. But you can see how it just keeps jumping around an awful lot. And that's because it's a sunny and windy day, so there's probably quite a lot of turbulence for that plane up there. And that's causing the atmosphere to refract the light differently over time, causing the sun to appear to jump around. Of course, any astronomy buff could have probably told me that. Just watch that jump around. And notice the sun approaching my fingers here. The sun moves one whole sun diameter every 2 minutes. And just testing that it isn't my camera that's doing all the jumping around, I've got it aimed at the doorknob of the shed down here. And here's what we're seeing. And it is not jumping around a whole lot. As for this auto-darkening welding filter, I got terrible picture quality out of that one. Possibly the auto-darken makes it worse. So I'm not using that one. It also made everything green. As for my geometry, that was off a little bit too. I researched it some more, and my estimate was I needed 8-degree inclination on here. It's actually 7.5, so I shimmed it back a little bit, and I'm not sure if my platform's perfectly level, so I shimmed that too to get that to aim at the sun. And I looked up on Google Maps what the angle of our house is and set that to that, just eyeballing on the screen. I'm using that to make sure I have this axis that the whole thing pivots on lined up with the North Pole. And here's the time-lapse that I captured. You can see a little bit of shaking around and then sometimes big jerky movements as I repositioned the camera to make up for a drift because my axes weren't lined up properly. The sharpness isn't optimal, partially because I was using a relatively small aperture, but also I think because my filters were less than perfect optically. Now in the lead-up it's a bit more shaky because I was showing this up to a friend and I was actually leaning against the porch railing, which caused a lot of vibration. And I was shooting frames at a 10-second interval because the whole thing is relatively slow progress. This is entering totality at 10 seconds per frame. The final transition was a matter of seconds, so I wish I'd use a shorter interval. And this is now in totality and actually using auto exposure, because every 10 seconds I took a manual exposure and an auto exposure. And you can see the little red geyser sticking out of the sun. And as the moon moves in front of it, you can actually tell that the sun is in a different position based on how the geysers stick out. And now halfway through totality, I pulled the filters, which resulted in a lot more light, but unfortunately it also threw the focus off. And here comes the sun again, and I quickly put the filters back in the lens for fear of burning a hole in my sensor. Now it's a little bit less sharp after totality, because pulling those filters out and putting them back in somehow threw off the focus. And I'm speeding this up a bit more because after totality is just not nearly as exciting. And a few photos. This is at nearly 95% occlusion, and it doesn't really look that different because our eyes and the camera do such a good job of adjusting for light levels. Though it does seem kind of odd that my flashlight lights up the ground as much as it does. And this photo was taken the very moment we entered totality. And this is during totality. It wasn't actually all that dark because the horizon was still bright, but it looks dark here because this one's with a flashlight. Same photo without a flashlight. The camera does a good job of compensating for light levels. An interesting takeaway from this is how well our eyes and our cameras are able to adjust for drastically different levels of light. And this time lapse here is of our driveway with the camera fixed at daylight exposure, timestamp on the bottom left, and you can see how really dark it gets. And you can see the driveway light turning on, top right, but it's barely visible with the daylight exposure because it's so much dimmer than daylight.
But the coolest part to me is this photo, which shows a plasma eruption sticking out from behind the moon. It's underexposed and fuzzy, but I don't see that sort of photo in social media very much.